Hello and welcome to this, the fourth of the Foden's Lockdown podcasts. This project is supported by Arts Council England through its Emergency Response Fund, which was developed due to the COVID-19 crisis. I'm John Barber, and in today's show we're joined by British Composer Award winner and Foden's former composer-in-residence Andy Scott. We catch up with the second part of our interview with the John Wilson Orchestra and BBC Big Band principal trumpet Mike Lovatt, and of course, a game that keeps everyone on the edge of their seat. Who's the mystery Foden's band member? As the challenges of face-to-face rehearsals are met by an ever-growing compendium of risk assessments and the mitigation of appropriate space and ventilation, the online brass band communities continue to provide a platform for those wishing to engage. And in the last month, there have been some wonderful events that are worthy of a mention. The Corey Band Online Entertainment Contest was a great success, with bands from around the globe having the opportunity to showcase their programmes across a number of evenings. This was really well put together and thoroughly enjoyable to watch, so congratulations to our friends at Corey for doing such a great job. Nearer to home, the Foden's Youth Band held their first virtual rehearsal day with over 40 band members joining us. Group warm-ups led to sectional rehearsals, quizzes, classes on playing slowly and beautifully, plus Gary Curtin leading a session on practice techniques to help you become a technical wizard before the whole band came together for mass performances of the Cossack, the hymn tune Nottingham, and African Funk. Huge thanks to Foden's band administrator Ian Raisbeck for putting such a great day together. And so to the first clue to this month's mystery band's person. On the day they were born, Madonna's Like a Prayer was at number one, having just elbowed Jason Donovan's Too Many Broken Hearts off the top spot. As an interesting aside, whilst research is yet to be complete, we do believe that on the date that Mark Wilkinson was born, the number one spot was Who's Sorry Now by Connie Francis. Who knew? Back in 2008, Foden's then principal E-flat bass Les Niche premiered a new concerto, Salt of the Earth, by British composer award winner Andy Scott. The performance at the RNCM Festival of Brass opened the door to a wonderful partnership between Foden's and Andy as composer in residence. I caught up with Andy as he reflected on his relationship with the band over the years. But before we hear that, let's take the opportunity to enjoy some of his music. It Seemed That Life Was So Wonderful is a track from Supertramp saxophonist John Helliwell's new CD, The Ever Open Door, which is being released worldwide in October by Challenge Records. The music is composed by John Helliwell and Andy Scott and features John Helliwell on tenor saxophone, John Ellis on Hammond organ, and the Sing String Quartet. Please sit back and enjoy It Seemed That Life Was So Wonderful. It gives me great pleasure now to welcome the band's former composer in residence, a position he delivered with enormous distinction for 10 years, Mr. Andy Scott. How are you?
I'm all right. Thanks, JB. Thanks for having me on here. And hello to everybody out there, all you Foden's fans.
Well, it's an absolute pleasure to see you face to face. I have seen you on the odd occasion walking your dog or dogs, as they are now, down the lane and keeping fit and healthy in these difficult times.
Yeah, absolutely. Obviously, you know, everyone would have said it's extremely strange times for musicians. I mean, Lauren and myself, my wife, Lauren, who's played with Foden's. She plays harp, as a lot of people know. But we're both self-employed musicians, so it's you just don't know what's happening from one day to the next. And obviously, safety is the main thing with everybody, stating the obvious. But then I look at some of the other musicians I know. There are a couple of West End musicians, and their job has just gone overnight. And they're the two that I was speaking to recently are both just relying on savings, praying that these theatres open fairly soon, or you know, it's really, really bad. So anyway, keeping fingers crossed for people like that and for everybody out there.
So what I really want to do, Andy, is take you right back to the start, talk about how the relationship with Foden's band and this amazing tenure that produced all this wonderful music came about. And back in sort of the mid-2000s, you were working with Les Nisch on a tuba concerto.
Yeah, that's right. Les approached me and I wrote him a 15-minute concerto called Salt of the Earth. That Foden's premiered at the RNCM Festival of Brass in January 2008. And it's funny how it works with commissions and word of mouth. Prior to that piece, Les plays in Tubularte, and I've written a piece for them. They commissioned a piece for a festival. But the first time I heard of Foden's was the mid-1980s, when I was at the RNCM, or late 1980s, and Martin Winter was in my ear, who at that point I think was principal cornet with Foden's.
Right.
And he was a good neighbour of mine, and we used to go out down to the local pub most Sunday nights if we were free and have a natter. So I was hearing all these stories about Foden's and so on. So it was actually lovely years later to finally make it down to the band room and to meet everybody and have the privilege of writing for the band for those 10, 11 years.
Amazing. And when you finally did write for the band, I remember distinctly the very first piece that you wrote, the most significant piece you wrote for us was A World Within, which obviously then became the title track of our first CD of your music that we've had the pleasure of recording. And it was conceived in this sort of series of episodes that were, in terms of the kind of musical style, very sort of different to a lot of the music that the band was playing at that time. What were your thoughts behind The World Within and how it panned out?
Yeah, there were several thoughts behind it. One was to do with, at that point, I was just getting to know everyone in the band and people associated with the band. And Peter Fletcher was the president of the band at that point. And I remember chatting to him, and he'd tell me stories about when he used to cycle to Crewe to hear Foden's play in the 1950s and all this sort of thing. And it struck me he had all these incredible memories all stored up there in his mind and in imagination. And that's so related to music itself. So there was that sort of concept behind The World Within. But then stylistically, I mean, we've done a lot of jazz gigs together. And so it was natural for me to bring in sort of jazz influences into my music. It just happened to be for brass band in this case. You need very open-minded players to maybe try something a little bit different. And the person at the front of the band is absolutely vital. They have to be on board. And Mike Fowles has been absolutely brilliant right from the beginning of that process. He's got so much energy. He's so kind of diligent. He's such a good musician. I have to thank him, actually. He's been a pleasure to work with, as it has been with the band.
Yeah, and he's a great driving force for Foden. This is actually not an uncommon thread that's come up in recent interviews. I remember talking to Mike Lovatt as well, and he was quite rightly identifying the contribution that Mike Fowles has made to a lot of the different stylistic playing and you know pieces that the band have worked through over the years. So yeah, hats off to Mike. Now over those 10 or 11 years, you've come up with a tremendous amount, not just of small commission-y pieces for the band for competitions or brass in concert or the concert performance, but really substantial works that for me, very often they're not just music. They're like events. They are so well conceived, and there's almost a theatre to them in addition to just the musical elements. And I've written a few down here. You know, Spirit of Mingus was one of my personal favourites. Child Like You, of course, part of the Commonwealth Games. We were involved with that. Of course, the Battle of Barossa, and more recently Edwin. They're all enormous pieces that are great tributes to you as a composer, but also to legacies for the brass band movement to enjoy now that they've been written. Just want to focus on Spirit of Mingus for a second. Now, this was a totally out of the box, left of field, and I don't know if it's being performed again. I have no idea. I really hope it has. But right from the offset with narration to the closing bars where the band are intermingling with the audience, what on earth was going through your head? And it's brilliant, but how did you come up with that?
Oh, thank you. Well, I mean, I played in various bands that played the music of Charles Mingus, and I loved the freedom and the chaos sometimes in some of his recordings and his approach, and letting musicians, they don't have to play what's on the paper all the time. You know, if they want to go off and do something else at some point, the music is allowed to change directions when he's with jazz improvising musicians. So in this case, it was looking at the kind of parameters, right? What can we do here? How can we create some interaction within the band that you might get in an improvisatory setting, but it's written down? So it might be the principal bass player, E-flat bass player, listens to someone else and then moves note or changes pitch when they hear something else going on that someone else is, you know, they've been told in this part, listen to that person. When they feel it's right, they can then change their next note, and there's a kind of chain reaction. There are things like that. And also I read a book about Mingus. It's a sort of semi-fictional autobiography. It's pretty wild. But he was saying he had three personalities. So we had narration in the piece as well, and what I made some words up, and there were things like I am three people, and then you think, okay, well that's all fine and dandy, but what's that got to do with music? So then it was like, let's bring three totally unrelated strands of music together and see if we can make them work at the same time. So it becomes, the challenge is contrapuntal at that point. So the, you know, it just kind of makes you as a composer think a lot more. The thing I have to be careful is sometimes I have misjudged it with one or two pieces, just thinking in general, and the concept takes over too much to the detriment of the development of the music sometimes. So it's a kind of fine balance.
Well, I don't know how long it took you to write that piece, but I appreciate what you're saying about trying to find the right balance and overstepping the mark, but I think it's only by overstepping the mark, you know, creatively, that you find out what not just what's possible, but also what people are prepared to allow themselves to do. Because you know, you have asked the band to step out of its comfort zone, and that's good. You know, it is really, even if the band don't necessarily enjoy it, that we benefit from that process, I think.
No, thank you. And I have to say, I should throw in there as well, because you're modest and you probably won't, but the concerto that I wrote you, that was about 25 minutes long, that you premiered at the RNCM with the band, Molecular Cocktail Party, where the whole of the solo part, or most of it, is improvised, and there aren't chord symbols written down or anything. You know, I write some of the pieces and I know damn well, you know, well, this is probably never going to be played again, so, because there aren't the musicians who can handle that solo part. But sometimes we just have to do things, because it's not all about the commercial side of it. It's about developing as musicians and being musically open-minded. And if you know, then if you can make that work in your life financially, then fantastic. But the Edwin piece was the other one, where I really took some risks and I just took it a bit too far, I have to say. And Mike Fowles, I should have listened to Mike Fowles, because Mike looked at the score. He said, "Andy, I think the best thing to do is maybe we should have a workshop on this, and then we can tweak a few things and do all this." I was like, "Mike, no, it's fine, it's fine. You know, I've written for the band for 10 years. He said, "No, no, we should do a workshop." "No, no, it's fine." And of course, we should have done a workshop, because there were some bits in it that were so hard. that you could call, you know, we needed to tweak them.
It's very magnanimous of you to admit that now. I have to say, when we first played through it, there were looks across the band of, "Gosh, that's hard." And I don't think the tuba players had ever been exercised so heartily up and down their sort of scales and arpeggios in the bass. I think they were very grateful when you let's say refined your piece. Yeah. But actually, the piece Edwin again, which was the last sort of major piece that you wrote for the band. I know there are still some projects ongoing, which we'll within our limited time we'll touch upon in a second. But Edwin again was really quite a poignant piece to as your last major composition. And obviously the narrative within it is very pictorial, but I mean, maybe you could say a little bit more about what Edwin is about.
Yeah, absolutely. So Edwin Firth, as a lot of you listening will know, was principal cornet of Foden's, and he was killed in battle in action near the end of World War One. He was killed on the 1st of June, 1918. So this piece, the band approached me to write this as a centenary. And also the other incredible thing was his cornet, Wilkie, played when the piece was premiered at the RNCM, that I thought, well, clearly there's got to be towards the end of the piece a big cornet cadenza to, representing Edwin. But Mark played that in the world premiere on Edwin Firth's cornet. Yeah, it was unbelievable. And then when you research things, you know, his regiment number was 766890. And then, you know, you start thinking, oh, I wonder how I can represent that in a theme of a piece. And I think, I can't remember, but I think I looked at a chromatic scale and took those numbers from his regiment number. And then the first, well, a lot of the piece was probably based around that. So also he was a watchmaker as well as playing in Foden's. So I wanted to use the percussion section at times for a kind of chiming effect. I know it's very cliched, but they all come together. It's exactly what happens with music when we work as an ensemble. We're individuals who need to shine at times and be the solo voice, but we're cogs. Yeah, we're all part of a bigger thing. So, that was... I was pleased with most of that piece, if I'm allowed to say so. But there's a three-minute in a section in it I'm not pleased with. And that was a stumbling block. And I think it's minutes 5 to minutes 8 or something like that. And at some point, I'm going to rewrite those 3 minutes.
This is hot off the press. So what is it about those 3 minutes that you're not so pleased with?
It's I wanted a kind of ostinato effect that I use, or riff effect that I've used in various pieces. And I tried to do that and get this watchmaker thing going on and have solos over it, but the balance and the colours just aren't right. So this is, as I was saying before, sometimes as a composer you might misjudge, or I do sometimes, the concept kind of takes over and maybe gets in the way of the music. And when I do sit down and look at those 3 minutes again, I think I will remove the concept and just look at what music is there, what the architecture and structure is, and just let the music lead it.
Maybe we should do a workshop on it. I don't know how you feel about that.
Can't possibly do that, John. Thanks for the offer, though.
as you look back across these you know, the years that you've been working with the band, obviously we mentioned all the big pieces, but are there any sort of moments or smaller pieces or other things that you've really enjoyed, or that the relationship with the band has afforded you to kind of, you know, take part in or invest your time in?
Yeah, I just think it's fascinating coming in to you know, as a non-brass player, but then coming in as a musician and working with a band like Foden's, because what I absolutely dearly love about Foden's and the brass band world, but you know, my experiences almost exclusively are with Foden's, is this camaraderie, the absolute professionalism, the kind of respect and friendship, and the fact that people actually want to be there. And that might sound like a strange thing to say, but believe me, I've been in some musical situations where people don't want to be there, and then and they're just looking at the clock and seeing when rehearsal finishes or the gig finishes. But pieces like Space Invaders, we had a great time coming up with a program for Brass in Concert. One of the pieces is all about space and so on, and we were just had these crazy ideas, I remember, and I ended up just getting on the phone and phoning Patrick Moore. There was a number on the internet for him, and I phoned it up, and he answered the phone. Patrick Moore. I was like, listen, we've got this idea for this Foden's program. He said, come to my house. So we did. He lives
amazing.
On the south. Yeah, he lives on the south coast, and we videoed him introducing some of the pieces for the program, and they were projected onto the big screen at the Sage when Foden's played there. And it's lovely little bits and bobs like that. And Bram Tovey, actually, Bram's been absolutely wonderful. And for that same program, he narrated a shortened version of My Mountaintop. And it's, you know, Howard Snell as well. You know, whenever I've met Howard and been in touch with him, he's so supportive and just such good people, you know. So, yeah, some of the smaller pieces, and also Ivor in Armagh. He commissioned a couple of pieces. You mentioned Battle of Brossa, but there was a shorter piece he commissioned as well. And when I've been over there with the band on two or three occasions, I think, again, it's just this camaraderie. It's this giving element. So seeing some of those kids in the workshops on the Saturday morning over in Armagh at that theatre is just absolutely wonderful to see. So hats off to Foden's.
Well, we feel very privileged to be able to contribute, you know, and it's great, and you know, and it's great that you are, and this is possibly the next point and the last point, is that you have been a significant part, but you are still involved, and there are a couple of projects that you're still writing for the band, and I saw something on Facebook where you were rather bravely, I have to say, entering Jimmy Charles's shed. you're writing something for him, I believe.
Yeah. Jimmy is an absolute legend. Everybody knows that. And, well, he keeps telling us. But, no, sorry.
But, he does. No,
he's wonderful. And it must have been 3 or 4 years ago now. I said to him, listen, Jimmy, I'm going to write a piece that's dedicated to you. Things are put on this kind of to-do list, but now's the time to do it. And I just thought, let's write it round at Jimmy's place. I've been round there, you know, over the years, and you sit in the back garden down by the shed and you just have a beer and have a chat and everything. So I said, Jimmy, can I write the new piece in the shed? So I think he's been out there dusting some of the cobwebs away. Well, and telling me how the spiders don't bite. So I'm going to go down there in about a week and start scribbling.
Oh, fantastic. Well, look, I believe it or not, we've been chatting for ages, and it's gone so quickly.
Sorry.
No, nothing I didn't expect. It's been as I absolutely sure I knew it would be. It's great to catch up, and only such a pity that it's such a short period of time to kind of really nod a hat in the direction of this enormous contribution that you've made to Foden's, and you know, as we've just indicated, will still be making in the future. So it's just to say thank you, and lovely to catch up, and look forward to colliding with you very soon.
Absolutely. No, thank you very much, John, and to everybody in the band. And I'll tell you what, I can't wait to just hear the band when everyone gets together and has a few rehearsals and starts doing gigs. That will be great.
Yes, maybe not the first rehearsal, because that might not be so great. But yes, we'll watch this. All right, listen, take care of yourself. Love to the family. See you soon.
Brilliant. Thanks, John. Cheers.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Born in London in 1881, Kenneth Alford was known as the British March King, having penned such great compositions as The Standard of St. George, Army of the Nile, and Voice of the Guns. Here Foden's present another one of his classic marches. This is On the Quarterdeck. ¶¶ Time now for the second clue as our mystery band's person. Whilst playing their instrument, our mystery person once fainted on stage and, in the ensuing moments, knocked out one of their front teeth. Ouch. Our mystery player now supports a £2,000 dental implant. In last month's podcast, I had the pleasure of speaking with lead trumpet of the BBC Big Band and the John Wilson Orchestra, Mike Lovatt. Here's the second part of that interview, where Mike talks about how his album 56 Degrees North came about, working with Colin Skinner, and offers some positive thoughts about the future.
I've always been interested in brass bands. I never ever played in one when I was a kid, but I was always thrilled by the sound of a brass band. And I realised over the years that all my favourite trumpet players had all had their beginnings in a brass band. So people like Derek Watkins, Morris Murphy, Bobby Pratt in Scotland, Stan Roderick, all the great players of yesteryear, they all started off in brass bands. And I've got a great friend called Paul Fisher. And Paul said to me, he runs the Amersham band, which is very close to where I live here. And he's doing great things with them. They've got this amazing new band room that they've built. The band's gone up into the
championship section.
Yeah, championship section band now, and he's really going places with them, which is fantastic. So I've always kept a sort of close eye on them. In fact, I did actually play at the Nationals in I don't know what year it was. It was when Andy Forbert was conducting that band, and they were in the fourth section, I think, then. And I actually played with them at the Albert Hall. And on their current band room wall, there is a picture of me outside the Albert Hall in the Amersham band uniform.
Wow. How did you, I have to, this is, I wasn't planning on going down this path, but how did you find that experience?
It was really unusual. I was kind of, wow, is this what happens? You know, and all the sort of signing up and I couldn't believe that these people sat in this, you know, curtained off area and had a bucket to pee in and all this kind of stuff. I couldn't believe it went on. And I couldn't believe that everybody played the same piece. It was like, well, everybody's playing the same piece. But it was amazing. I mean, the Albert Hall is such a great place to play in, isn't it? You know. But anyway, so the Amersham band was the thing that sort of got me started with brass bands. And Paul just got in touch with me and he said, I'm doing a concert, a joint concert with Foden's band. You could play some solos with Amersham in the first half, and then the second half, you can play some solos with Foden's. And I went, Foden's, they're like one of the top bands, aren't they? And he said, yeah, I want you to hear them. So anyway, this concert was organised. You'll probably remember the concert, John. And
quite a warm day, I seem to recall.
It was a warm day, almost as warm as today. and it was fantastic. I loved it. And, you know, when I heard Foden's play, I'm not just saying this because you're at the other side of this call, but it was absolutely electrifying. I couldn't believe that a band of brass players like that could get so many tone colours, could play with so much beauty and so much exhilarance. It was, everything was packed into this, you know, one half of the concert. And my wife, Anne, said it. She was in the audience. She said exactly the same thing. She was bowled over by it. Anyway, and I loved the atmosphere with the band as well. It was really nice. I felt connected with the band. And so a few weeks later, Paul said, you know what you should do? You should do an album. I said, well, yeah, I've been meaning to do an album for, you know, it's like getting an orchestra together. He said, no, not with an orchestra, with a brass band. I said, an album with a brass band, it wouldn't really suit what I do, you know. And he said, well, just get some new arrangements done. So the seed was sown. And like for weeks after that, I kept getting these texts or phone calls from Paul going, have you spoke to Mark Wilkerson yet? Have you booked the band? Have you sorted the date? And I'm thinking like, how am I going to afford this? I don't know. I don't know how to do this. I don't know how to go about it. And he said, speak to Adam Goldsmith at World of Sound. And he's the guy to record brass bands. He knows exactly what he's doing, you know. So it all started to move. And then we had later on, that was 2017, I think, or 16, 2017. And towards the end of that year, my father-in-law, who was the grand old age of 97, was in a care home near to us. He was actually Scottish, but we brought him down near to us, and he came to live down here. Saw a lot of him during that time, and sadly, just before Christmas 2017, he passed away. And so the album at this point was in the planning stages, but my wife said, look, you've got to do this now, and just, you know, do it as a tribute to Dad, you know. And so that's what we did. And so that, hence the title of this album, 56 Degrees North, which is a kind of subtle way of a tribute to him, because he was born in a place called Crossford in Fife, Scotland, which the coordinates are 56 degrees north. So that's how the title came about.
It's an incredible album, and being on the other side in, you know, one of those people who was lucky enough to be there for the recording, it's astonishing, the not just your playing, but the colours that are created within that. You mentioned the colours before, and a lot of that is to do with, you've mentioned Paul said get some new arrangements, yeah. And for those new arrangements, you asked Colin Skinner. Now, Colin Skinner, I spoke to him about this when we were at the recording, and I asked him what experience he had of writing for brass bands, because we were all of us to a man were blown away just how creative and wonderful and the sound works and the textures that he'd come up with. And he said he'd never written for a brass band before, and I was like, what, how how is that possible? And he said, yeah, I was really nervous. I wasn't quite sure how to write for a euphonium, whether it should be doubling a tube line or have its own independent. It's such a strong voice. And he clearly thought so much about this thing. And he'd read one book written by somebody 60 or 70 years ago. He'd obviously consumed all of it, as the amazingly intelligent guy he is. And then he just put it to paper. And it's amazing.
It is amazing. You know, I've known Colin a long, long time. And he went to the, he studied bassoon. Classical bassoon at the Scottish Academy, Scottish Conservatoire, it's called now, Royal Conservatoire of Scotland, let's get the title right. And he came down to Trinity to do a postgrad, Trinity College of Music. And I'd just left that at that point. And somebody said to me, oh, there's this guy that's come down. He's a bassoonist, but he plays saxophone as well. And he writes. He's quite a good arranger. He's really getting into it, you know. And eventually I met him and we got on like a house on fire. We had the same musical taste and everything was, it just worked, you know. And we ended up playing eventually in the Glenn Miller UK band, which was a band set up, the Glenn Miller Orchestra, set up from the estate of Glenn Miller in New York. And it was an official name, it was a licensed name given to a band. And the band was formed by Ray McVeigh, who used to be an old dance band leader, he used to be a Mecca dance band leader. And I got asked to play in it, and Colin did as well. And at that point, he was looking for somewhere to stay, to live. And we moved in together in a flat in the East End of London. And we used to travel to gigs together and all that kind of stuff and talk about music. And so he's always somebody that, like I say, our taste and everything was really together in music. So when Paul said get somebody to do some arrangements, it was obvious to me that Colin was the guy to do it. So I said to Colin, look, I want it to be, you know, you can think big fat brass a bit, but I want to have a jazz rhythm section. I don't want tubas doing walking bass lines. I want them to do what tubas do. And I want a bass player to do what the bass player does. So we managed to get together a ridiculous rhythm section of ridiculous, as in ridiculously good. Matt Skelton on drums, Jeremy Brown on the bass, and Graham Harvey on piano. And Colin set about doing these arrangements. We had some meetings. He suggested a few things. I had tunes in my mind I wanted to do, and it was absolutely incredible how he just came up with these ideas. And I'll never forget turning up at Foden's band room and hearing the band play one of those charts for the first time. And that was even without the rhythm section being there, just the band. I was absolutely gobsmacked that the, like you say, the colours and the feel that the band played with. You know, this is a brass band. And anybody that's heard the album will know that in parts, Foden's band sounds like one of the greatest light orchestras that you will ever hear. And in other parts, it sounds like one of the greatest classical orchestras ever here. In another part, it sounds like one of the great swinging big bands. And it really does. And that is a testament to the band, but also, like you said, to Colin's writing.
Yeah, it was an absolute joy for all of us involved to be part of it, and an album we keep on going back to. You know, that we've all over the years been handed discs that have had various different roles, either scraping the ice off your car or doubling up as a coffee mug. But yours is not one of those. Far from it. So, well done. You passed the coffee mug test.
That's good. Glad to hear that.
The music on the album is very personal to you. You obviously spent a lot of time thinking, and you've just alluded to it and discussing with Colin the tracks that you wanted to do there. Could you maybe just tell us about one track in particular that meant a lot to you, that you were really keen to get onto the album?
Sure. There's a track on the album called Mame, and it's by Jerry Herman. It's from the show. And when I was a kid, I think I said earlier on that I used to play along to records in my bedroom. That was one of the things I did. I'd run home from school, I'd play along with the Philip Jones Brass Ensemble, I'd play along with the Sid Lawrence Orchestra, I'd play along with the Liverpool Phil, whoever it was on this particular recording of the record that I put on, I would play along, and lots of different styles, and that was going to be a theme really for the rest of my playing life. But there was one record which I went on holiday to Scarborough, and I walked into this record shop, and there was this little carousel thing, and there was this album, and it was just facing me, and I was just like a magnet drawn to this thing, and it was Kenny Baker, one of the great trumpet players of the UK, and of course another guy who started off in brass bands. He was a cornet player. Anyway, I brought this up, bought this album, and it was £1.99, and I got it home and started to play along with it, and Mame was on this album. So now we fast forward a bit to recent times, and the arranger of that was Roland Shaw. And Roland Shaw was being looked after by a great singer called Eleanor Keenan. She used to sing with the Sid Lawrence Band. And I said to Eleanor, I said, do you mind asking Roland if he's still got any of the scores which he did for Kenny Baker? And so she did, and she started looking through stuff, couldn't find it anywhere. She said, I've got another idea. She said, I know Kenny's widow really well. She lives down in Bognor. I'll get in touch with her. So she got in touch with her and found out that she just decided to get rid of any of the music that she had that Kenny had owned, and it was all in her garage. So I was invited down with Eleanor. We drove down there on a Friday morning or something, and through all the rush hour, terrible traffic, I got to the house and I was dying for the loo. I was absolutely dying for the loo. And I went in and said, hello. And she said, oh, nice to meet you, Mike. I said, really sorry, I could really do with the toilet. And she said, yeah, it's just over there. And I walked into I opened the door of this toilet, and I just stopped in the tracks like that. All the walls had all this Kenny Baker memorabilia all over them, pictures of him with Dizzy Gillespie, pictures of him, you know, the London Palladium, pictures of him when he was he was a household name, he was a star. And so it was incredible. I'm in Kenny Baker's house. So she said, I took my original album with me and showed her that. I gave her some recordings that I'd done, like with John Wilson Upton and BBC Big Band. And she gave me a cup of coffee. And she said, it's just through here. We went through to this garage. There was all this music everywhere. And I started looking through it. And about an hour and a half later, she came in and she said, have you found what you're looking for? I said, no. And she said, she said, I like you. She said, so just back your car up to the garage door and put it all in the boot and take it away, please.
Wow.
I ended up getting, it's mainly the Baker's Dozen stuff. Kenny had a broadcasting band called the Baker's Dozen, and I managed to get all that music. So still, after going through all this music, I didn't have the main piece. So fast forward now to a couple of years ago, maybe more than a couple of years ago, I had a big birthday, and Colin Skinner turned up at a party that I had, and he said, happy birthday, mate, and he got this big sort of Perspex thing with a handle on it. And I opened it up, and it was the original score to Mame and all the parts. And in fact, not just that, most of the tracks off that particular album. And unbeknownst to me, Colin Skinner had been given some of the Roland Shaw library when Roland finally passed away. And Colin had gone through it, and he knew that I'd been looking for that stuff for years, and so he gave it to me. So that was then the basis of the main arrangement on the album. And I always remember when I was a kid being amazed by the fact that the violins on one section in the middle sort of did all this. And Colin said, well, what about, how are we going to do that? I said, look, I want it to be exactly like the original. I'm going to play Kenny's original solo. And I said, just give it to the cornets. They'll be able to do that. And sure enough, I said about going into the band room, hearing the band play that for the first time. It was breathtaking. The cornets just rattled that off like it was, you know, playing Three Blind Mice. It was amazing. And it's still, every time, that's the opening track, and it's got the bop, 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 it goes like this opening, and it's yourself on the trombone. And I don't know whether you've ever heard the original. If you haven't, I'll send it to you, because it sounds just like it. Even the you know, I sent that to Adam Goldsmith as well. I said, can you make, I want the sound, the actual recorded sound, to be like this. And it's like 1969 or something, you know. It's a old-fashioned sound, really. But he nailed that as well in that room we recorded in Manchester. But you can see I get very excited by these things.
Well, rightly so. I mean, it means it's why we do music, isn't it? It means so much to us. It's more than just a job. And thankfully, at the moment, you know.
That's a long story. Please don't
apologise. We'll make it run over four episodes. It's fine. You've always been such a positive force, and I wonder at this time, when the music industry is facing so many challenges, for young people especially out there, maybe members of school groups, an area ensemble, a choir, an orchestra or a brass band, who might be feeling unmotivated and considering walking away from music and taking up a new hobby, would you have any words of possible encouragement for them at this difficult time?
Yeah, I always draw back onto something that happened to me when I was young, and I was 14. I've talked about playing along with records in my bedroom. I was also a very keen cyclist. And on one particular day, early September, I decided to go out on a bike ride after school. And I'd sort of do 30, 40 miles, not think anything of it. But on this particular occasion, I went out with a friend of mine. We got to a country lane with sort of 9 foot high hedges, a T-junction. And my friend went across, turning right, and I waited because I could hear a car coming and I thought it was coming from my left. So I waited, just stood over the crossbar. This car came up, and just as the car came up, there was a flash and a car was coming down the hill. Now, it was so narrow that there was no place for them to pass. So the guy coming down the hill decided that to avoid a head-on collision, he would turn into me, which knocked me off my bike. And in those days, cars used to have like a little gutter on the top of the roof. And that went across my mouth, knocking teeth out and lacerating my top lip. And at that particular moment in my life, I thought that was it for not just trumpet playing, but for music for me. I thought, that's it. I can't do it now. I won't be able to play. Blah, blah, blah. But it never, that love, that faith in music never went away from me. And within 6 months, even though I didn't have any teeth in the bottom, the front anyway, I started to play the trumpet again. And, you know, within 18 months from there, I took my grade 8 and got a distinction. So I was lucky that I managed to do it. And I had a peripatetic teacher, but you know, in those days, people weren't really keen, you know, they weren't really, the knowledge of embouchure training and wasn't like it is now. And, you know, it was trial and error. And I was very lucky that I managed to get playing again. And I tell this story not because people can go, oh, isn't that amazing? Mike can play like he can, even though he had this accident. It was my faith then. Music was something which just drew me with it, and I couldn't let go of it, whatever. And I think if you really love your music, carry on listening to music, carry on listening to people play. You know, listen, if you hear something and you think, wow, that's amazing, then try and play along with it. You know, put your Spotify on or your whatever it is you use these days, and play along with it, and take that inspiration and use that as the food to carry on. Because one day, especially for younger players, it will return. And if you really want it, then you'll do it. And that's what I'd say to people. Keep the faith.
Well, Mike, thank you very much. And, you know, solid words. And hopefully I think people will latch on to that. I think that's what we need to do. We need to believe that it is something that's with us now, but won't be forever. And that hopefully sometime in the near future we'll be able to get back to doing what we all love and get back playing again. And additionally, I hope that we get to see you back on the stage sometime soon, hopefully with Foden's. Thank you ever so much for taking the time to spend a short period of time. I won't let on how long we've been chatting for. It's been honestly absolute joy to chat to you and hear all the stories. So thank you so much.
Thank you, John. It's been a pleasure.
All right. Thanks, Mike.
Yeah, cheers.
You are listening to Mike Lovatt and Foden's performing Jerry Herman's Mame, taken from Mike's wonderful solo album 56 Degrees North. Well worth getting hold of a copy if you haven't already. And so to the final clue as to the identity of this month's mystery bands person. Prior to their current job, our bands person worked in a pharmacy, possibly mixing up some painkillers for their front tooth. Who knows? I'm sure that many of our listeners will have worked it out by now. However, if not, our mystery bands person for today's podcast is Foden's fantastic flugel player, Melanie Weil. I had the opportunity to catch up and interview Mel inside what sounds like a small metal box, which hopefully explains some of the interesting sound quality. Fortunately, though, despite the sound, what Mel had to say was great.
Delighted today to be joined by the Foden's mystery bands person. It is our amazing flugelhorn player, Melanie Weil. Melanie, how are you?
Hello, John. I'm great. Thank you.
Lovely to see you, and thanks for joining us to make this recording. Now, you've been in Foden's seemingly for an absolute age. However, do you hail from a musical family originally?
Yeah, I don't come from a family of brass banders, but my dad does play the guitar, and I remember he used to sing with me when I was little, so I guess that's where my interest in music first came from.
Do you know what? My dad plays the guitar as well. He's also, there's no other sort of musicians. Well, my sister is musical, but my dad plays guitar, and I distinctly remember it being the thing when we were having birthday parties at the age of 6 and 7 and 8, that he would come out and play these kind of folky tunes. And at that age, I thought it was really cool, you know.
Yeah, I did, yeah.
When he did it at my 18th birthday party, it was just a bit awkward, but early days, it was pretty cool. So your dad was a guitarist, but how did you end up playing cornet?
So when I was in primary school, I very briefly had violin lessons, but I had to give those up because I moved schools. And then after that, I still knew that I wanted to play an instrument. So when I moved up to high school, my form tutor kindly said that I could borrow her son's cornet, as he'd recently moved on to tuba. What? So once I'd learned how to play that, I was able to join the school band. And the school that I went to had a really outstanding music department, and the opportunities we had were really amazing. We were like an adult band going out playing concerts nearly every weekend, and we played in competitions, and we travelled abroad to play competitions. So obviously I'm really grateful that I had that opportunity.
Wow, where was this school?
Abraham Darby School in Telford.
Oh gosh, yeah. And they're still a great music department now, aren't they?
Amazing, yeah.
Wow. Well, how to talk about a postcode lottery, how to land on your feet. Amazing. But and actually, and obviously it's made such an impression that actually playing the cornet and teaching the cornet has become a way of life for you. So, you know, day to day you work in various different places. We're incredibly fortunate at the Love Music Trust. You do some work for us, but also I know you're very, very busy in Cheshire West and other places. How's the lockdown affected your day to day or your job?
Well, it's been very interesting. Obviously, it's a very challenging time for everybody involved in education. So when the lockdown first happened, schools stopped allowing visitors at all. So we really quickly had to learn how to teach remotely. So I find teaching over Zoom took a bit of trial and error. Like, not everything works like it does in real life. And then we also had to make videos of us teaching to send home to the children. So I did have some fun learning how to edit videos and make them interactive for the children.
Good use of the describing word fun there. Excellent. Well done. now you, when you joined the band, as I said at the start, you are now the flugel player and quite brilliant at it. You know, and recipient of Band's Player of the Year. And I seem to remember in your first year as flugel player, you had two of the most horrendous solos. I seem to remember Bram made you stand up on your feet. I can't remember how else you'd stand, but stand on your feet at the front of the stage to deliver this thing. And I remember all of us were sitting there thinking, oh, poor girl, poor girl. And it was brilliant. You know, I mean, fair credit to you. You know, you've done a fantastic job on flugel, but you didn't join on flugel. You joined the band on cornet initially. And then when the opportunity arose, you transitioned onto flugel. Was that a straightforward thing, or were there challenges doing that?
I think the challenges were the ones you've just mentioned, really. I feel like that first year I moved over, I was given a bit of a baptism of fire in terms of contesting. So the area, it wasn't too bad. There was a solo in that. And then, as you said, the open, we did the Triumph of Time, and like two-thirds of the middle movement of that is a flugel solo. But I think I was quite lucky that Bram agreed to come back to the band at that time, because he's a really great teacher and he helped like bring the best out of me. So I didn't think that I'd be able to play from memory at the front of the Symphony Hall the year previous to that. I couldn't believe that I'd gone from playing rep like a year before that to standing at the front of the stage at the Open. But the band came 17th that day, do you remember?
Mel,
maybe it wasn't quite so good.
It's indelibly saddened on my soul. Yes.
But then the contest after that was the Nationals. Do you remember that one? We also had a massive flugel cadenza in it. So this is where the band stopped playing, and it was just me for like 2 or 3 minutes with a bit of like twinkly percussion going on in the background. And so Bram worked with me on this again, and he said, right, I really like how you're playing it, but I'm worried that you're going to not be able to project into the Albert Hall. He said, I think you're too short. And I thought, well, there's not really much I can do about that. Wow. And he said, well, his suggestion was that we get a wooden box made we stand on. And I remember having to carry this big wooden box thing around London. And then I had to stand on that in the Albert Hall and play my solo. But it actually went really well. I was pleased with how it went. And then I always think that if I can get through that first year of playing flugel, I won't be too much coming as bad as that.
Was that Journey of the Lone Wolf?
Yeah.
Oh, yes. A really, really great piece. So actually what we're saying is the challenges that you felt weren't so much the physical challenges of moving from one instrument to another, but actually the sheer pressure that you
just sort of got thrown into.
More or less, you got to a solo C, and then you were made to earn your stripes in big sort of big return of trust. Well, as I say, and that was the year that you quite rightly, I think, you won the band's player of the year, because it was, I think, you deserved it because your playing was spectacular. But even if it wasn't, I think just out of sheer sympathy, you would have walked it. Well done you. So listen, as I mentioned at the start, you've been in the band now for quite a while. As you look back over the time, and I realise that, you know, there's still a load of looking forward when we get back to playing, which we will do eventually. But when you do look back over your years with the band, what's your fondest memory up to this point?
I'm kind of hoping you wasn't going to ask this question, just because I think it would be far too difficult to choose just one single thing. Of course, I like winning contests like everybody else does. I was in the band in 2012 when we did the double, and that was a good day. I think I just love being able to play my instrument and all the amazing performance opportunities that we get with the band. We get to travel lots of places that I probably wouldn't have got to go otherwise. And I really like how we work on like new and interesting projects all the time. So we work with musicians outside of banding, and we get to play a lot of new music by different composers. So I think those are the kinds of things that I look back fondly on, but I wouldn't like to choose just one.
Well, it's very very diplomatic and politically correct of you. So well done. Mel, believe it or not, we're kind of there. It's great to catch up with you. And hopefully at some point in the near future, when we're able to, with a bit more confidence, get back to band, we'll see each other face to face. But in the meantime, thank you very much indeed. Stay safe, and speak to you very soon.
Thank you, John.
Cheers, bye.
Sadly, that brings our fourth Foden's Lockdown podcast to a close. Huge thanks to our guest Andy Scott, Mike Lovatt, and of course, Melanie Weil for joining us today. Thanks also to our audacious audacity whiz, Ian McKnight, for fixing the seams of our production. We'll be back next month to meet more members of the extended Foden's family, but until that time, please stay safe and keep on buzzing.